we're going to come back to the council agenda. We're up to item four, which is an item that we carried over from a previous meeting, and it's in regard to an agreement with Coffin Associates for a classification and compensation study. So, Ms. Keith, would you like to give us, I gather you're giving us the staff report because you're at the podium, so.
Good evening. As was mentioned, the council reviewed this item on November 13th, 2007, and had requested some additional information from staff, which was provided in the staff report. I'm just going to touch on a few of those highlights tonight. Additionally, Coffin Associates representative is present this evening to answer any additional questions about the class comp study and their proposal to the city council. The city's classification and compensation plan requires a necessary update at this time, with class specifications that are in line with current changes and requirements by law. Some of the information that the city council had looked for was what's the goal of a classification study, and that is that it was to study the city's job positions and create updated and objective classification descriptions that are legally compliant, internally aligned, reflective of contemporary standards, and accurately reflect current roles, responsibilities, duties, and qualifications. Identifying the body of work that is performed by an employee, as well as the knowledge, skills, abilities, and minimum requirements regarding education, years of experience, certifications, licenses, and other training, is crucial for any organization to function properly and to maintain effective business operations. Further, the compensation portion of the study typically does involve a total compensation market survey, including salaries and benefits, using a set of appropriate comparative agencies, which the city's already identified seven surrounding cities. It also provides an opportunity to make sure that there's internal equity for all positions, so that you're not suffering from compaction from your various unions and negotiating groups depending on certain types of qualifications. Because depending on what those are, you don't necessarily want a subordinate making more than their department head, for example. Typically, cities bring in outside resources to perform these studies. For several reasons. One of them is to provide an unbiased third-party expert opinion and make independent recommendations without having a real or perceived conflict of interest. This is important with union and non-union environments to ensure that the data collection, analysis, and interpretation, as well as their recommendations, do not support any individual internal city agendas. The scope of the particular project before you is basically four elements: an update to the classification plan, an update to the compensation plan, an internal equity method for linking the plans together, and a labor market data for gauging the city's relative competitiveness with respect to surrounding agencies. As was mentioned previously, the fiscal year budget does allocate $36,000 from the internal service funds, not the general fund, for the purpose of doing this study. The additional $545 that would be needed would be taken out of general operations. The council has several alternatives before them this evening. Staff is recommending that the council authorize the city manager to enter an agreement with Coffin Associates for the completion of the comprehensive classification and compensation study in the amount not to exceed $36,545. But the council may also elect to just do the classification study in the amount not to exceed $25,680, or the council may elect to authorize the city manager to enter into an agreement to do just the compensation portion for $13,365, or the city council may elect to reject the proposals and provide further direction to staff. Are there any questions?
Madam Mayor?
Yep. Go ahead, Joe.
Do we currently have a classification grid or matrix?
We have a salary matrix.
A salary matrix.
Based on certain negotiating groups.
What's the difference between the form that we have now and the form that we will ultimately have if we spend this money?
Part of it will be part of the job descriptions that we have now. Right now, all of our job descriptions, what we try to do is as there's turnover and we vacate positions, if they're standalone positions, we try to update them. If they're independent positions, that's a little harder because you'd have to update them for the other employees, and if they're in a union, it's a meet and confer item, and you can't do that without the unions agreeing to that process.
Can you give me some examples of what the difference is? what the importance of this difference? I mean, how will it play out in real life? I mean, I'm trying to conceptualize what the difference is.
One of the best examples that really I've thought of is to give you an idea. When I was first hired with the city, I was originally hired as an assistant recreation director. And I was in the management group of the employees. At that point in time, because we hadn't done one in a while, for the same reason, the janitor of the city was making more money than I was. I was responsible for a $2 million department budget and 45 part-time employees, and he was making a dollar more an hour than I was. This type of study looks at all of those internal equity issues as well as the job responsibilities of those employees and gives you that information so that you can make those corrections where necessary.
All right.
John, did you have any questions?
No, not at this time.
Okay. Councilmember?
No questions this time.
Okay. I have a question. Are there occasions where not having a current classification study have led to confusion or problems or, I mean, can you tell us, and I think that's part of what Mayor Pro Tem Mosca was getting at. What are the consequences of not doing this? Have we had situations where there really was a problem because of the lack of clarity?
We currently have several of those situations. And instead of doing it on a case-by-case basis, it's more economical for the city to do it on an overall basis than to get into the individual circumstances.
Okay. And those are around job duties and
job duties, job responsibilities, classification of employees. Should they be in this union or this non-represented union based on their job responsibilities and duties?
Okay. Does it get into whether they should be exempt or non-exempt as well?
Yes, it does.
Okay. Thank you. That's all I had. All right. And I think we do have a representative here from Coffin Associates, and maybe he or she could come up and tell us a little bit about your firm and your qualifications for this type of study.
Good evening to the council. My name is Katie Kaneko, and I'm the president of Coffin Associates. Coffin Associates is a 24-year-old human resources consulting firm. About 70% of our business is in classification and compensation studies. And we provide services to cities, counties, special districts, and so we have a vast amount of experience doing these sorts of studies. I myself will not be the project manager, but the chief executive officer of our firm, Georg Kramer, who's on vacation, will be running this project. We have a proven methodology, incorporates all stakeholders, so we get employee representation as well as management representation and city management involved in the process so that we hear all aspects of the issues that are at hand. It's extensive. We have employee orientations, communicating our methodology and process to all employees. We then incorporate their input through position description questionnaires. We interview each employee to fully understand their job responsibilities. We also interview their supervisors and management group to get their perspective on that as well. And then through that process, go back and develop up-to-date, current, legally compliant classification descriptions. Once those are approved, that becomes the overarching structure to go out to the labor market and get the compensation data to ensure that you're paying competitively. That in a nutshell is our process. I don't know if you have any other questions about our qualifications or our methodology.
Questions?
It is a full total compensation study that we are proposing, that which would be not only salary data, but a quantitative analysis of benefits as well, including retirement, insurances, and various leaves. So the costs of those programs to the city.
So the compensation side of the study just shows whether or not your positions or the positions are competitive with positions in the surrounding areas, which we already know are not.
Okay.
The classification side, why does cities hire you to do this classification, and they're motivated to do that purely because, legally speaking, their classification study has to be compliant with ADA and other stuff?
ADA as well as FLSA. And it also assists if there are grievances or disciplinary actions or performance management issues that need to be addressed. And again, you know, that there's an equitable system, that people are placed and paid according to the body of work that they're performing.
Sorry, Mayor.
I was just going to ask what FSLA was.
I was going to ask what that acronym meant as well. Yeah.
The Fair Labor Standards Act determines exempt and non-exempt status and determines how you get paid.
Actually, California law is different from FALSA, though, so you're doing a different analysis even at that level.
Well, it's very, very similar, actually.
I have a couple of questions based on some of the discussion that we had at the last meeting. I guess one of the questions that came up is, well, we know we're already below market rate, so what do we need to study to find that out? What are the benefits of having the salary, and this refers specifically to the salaries study?
Well, I mean, I think most people want to attract and retain a quality staff, and usually that's what's sought after in conducting this sort of study. And if you already know that you're behind the market, at least you can assess how far behind, and we also will make recommendations on implementation plans. How can we slowly get there based on our budget, or where do we want to be? What's our compensation philosophy, and where do we want to fall? I'm not privy to what your issues are, if you are having a difficult time retaining employees or attracting employees. But that would be a high motivation, at least to come up with a philosophy and a game plan on how you're going to address some of those issues.
Do you know if your clients ever use your studies to actually reduce salaries or eliminate positions?
Well, the classification piece may very well. I mean, we have, you know, 24 years of experience and industry knowledge, and there may be situations where a division or department is not set up efficiently. We may recommend consolidating classification so that you have more a general classification that runs throughout the city, which also can result in ease of administration. So reducing salaries is never an objective. In fact, we don't recommend it. If employees were in a situation where they were making over the market, we would recommend Y rating or holding them at that level until the market caught up.
I had a question. Once these, let's say you make a determination of salary levels, have you ever had a case where they're used in the court of law to file a lawsuit against the city for their rates being lower than what your recommendations are?
No, we've never run into that situation. You know, again, this is a tool for the city to use to develop some sort of compensation philosophy. Of course, you're limited to what your budget constraints are and what you can afford and all of that, but it does give you an idea of where you stand, and you can make informed decisions on compensation.
I also have a question about the classification portion, really the same question that I asked Michelle. What is having the, since nobody can find any record that we've ever done this. Mm-hmm. So what is having, and the question has been raised, well, why can't we do it in-house? Why do we need, you know, an external firm to do it? What are we going to get by having, you know, an experienced firm prepare this for us? What are the types of situations that might arise where having this study and being able to refer to it, let's say in our complaints or grievances filed by employees about their job duties or something like that, we're having this as going to help the city's position.
Well, Michelle's example was actually one of the most extremes I've ever seen, where, you know, a janitor was actually making more than an assistant of a department. But that's a very good one in this case. You know, classification is going to give you knowledge about the body of the work that's being performed and the abilities and requirements and education and experience that the industry requires of a position like this. You then have that at hand to attract and recruit. If you don't know what you're hiring for, it's hard to recruit for candidates. Once a candidate is in place, you need to know they need to know what's expected of them in performing the job. And this comes into play, again, in evaluating how a performance is, results of performance on a year-to-year basis, as well as if there are performance issues or misunderstandings about what's expected. So if you don't have it documented, it's really difficult to determine if an employee is meeting or not meeting expectations. It also identifies training opportunities. It helps in retention by providing potentially career ladders or other incentives to stay on within an organization. There are multiple uses for having a strong classification system, as well as being able to adequately compensate or determine what the compensation is for those levels.
Okay, I think our city attorney wanted to add something too.
I know one aspect of your question was, what are the advantages to having an outside consultant do it versus having in-house staff do it? Mm-hmm. And without reference, this doesn't refer to anything going on here in Sierra Madre, but just in general terms, as your city manager, if there is a dispute over whether or not someone is exempt or is getting the appropriate pay, or whether they've been asked to do something outside of their job classification or so on, those kinds of complaints often come in the context of a claim that they are being retaliated against or discriminated against, or that there's some bad blood, if you will, with other city staff. And so to have this information come from an outside consultant, from an independent party who's not part of the fray, is very helpful in defending the city's position. So if, in the hypothetical world, if I was to be asked to defend the city in making certain determinations about employees' responsibilities and how they're compensated and so on, or your labor council were to do that, it would be much easier to do that with an outside consultant's classification study than with our own in-house documentation. It just carries more weight if you ever have to go to court or argue with another lawyer about it.
Okay, thank you. What if you do the study and you find out we're doing things that are illegal? Then what?
We would definitely bring that to the attention of the city.
Okay.
And we prepare a final report and of course, recommendations on how to get compliance, mm-hmm. get back in compliance. So,
but it doesn't add any risk to it. We're already in the risky situation if it turns out we are doing something that is not.
It would be important. Well,
since we've never done this sort of study
right.
before.
Right. Yeah. It would be important to know, what you're dealing with when you bring that to your attention.
Okay. All right. Thank you. I any other questions? All right. Thanks very much.
Sure. You're welcome. Thank you.
All right, well, let me open this up for public comment on this item.
Angus, 405 North Cannon. Am I correct in assuming, as the residents have been told, that the city is in somewhat of a financial crisis to the extent that there have been threats of possibility having to close the library or discontinue certain services if we cannot gather the funding to pay our police, to pay our paramedics, and to pay our essential services? I believe I'm correct. Is that not correct, that we are in a financial crunch?
You know what I know on the subject.
Would you say that's a yes answer?
Well,
Mayor Joffe?
We've all been to the meetings, so
giving me an evasive answer. I presume that is yes. Let me ask someone who will not be evasive, Kurt Zimmerman. Are we?
Yes, we're in a financial.
We're
crunch.
In a financial. That's the kind of direct answer that the community expects and wants. So why this study now? In other words, Mayor Joffe, former Mayor Buchanan, were part of a past council with Rob Stockley, Tanya Torres, and George Maurer. Why was this not brought into focus at that time? It's very negligent to me that they did not look into that. And why is the urgency of having this done now? Question. I have other comments I'd like an answer.
Why don't you finish your comments?
Well, some of my other questions might relate to your answer.
Well, I'd like you to finish your comments, and then I'll turn it to staff to see if anyone respond.
Other question. We have recently had some very important new staff members, and I'm very pleased to find that we have a new city manager who was hired within recent months. And in this report, it says here that one of the purposes of this classification is to identify the body of work that is performed by each employee, as well as the knowledge, skills, abilities, minimum requirements regarding education, years of experience, and I won't read the whole thing in the essence of time. So I would ask the city manager, was this not made clear to her when she applied for the job? Did we violate any of this? Was her classification not adequate? And not only our city manager, but we have recently hired a new financial director. Is Karen still on maternity leave, incidentally? Will she be coming back?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we hired her. We've hired another assistant in the financial department. We have just hired a development services directory. So have they been hired within this recent time without the proper clarification of their duties or their abilities or providing their educational capabilities as is defined on page 2 of the staff report on this? That's another question, because that seems incredible to me that we would even advertise without having proper classification, without having proper sense of compensation, etc. So, and there are many other staff, as you know. We have many more staff. We are currently advertising, I believe, for some administrative assistant. That might not be the right term. And why not? And I think it was well taken at the last council meeting. Councilmember Mosker, and I think supported by comments by Councilmember Watts, and certainly from myself from the podium, asked why this could not be done in-house. Now, the consultant has provided a very good report, and if they didn't, they wouldn't be in business, and they wouldn't be used, so we expect that from a consultant. And they are saying third party, la, la, la. So is this an urgency? And we have not had, this report is really not complete, because it does not address the question that was asked by Mr. Mosker to come back with the possibility of having it done in-house. And the community services director slash personnel director, when she came to the podium, she said, yes, it could be done. Her words, yes, it could be done. But she would not have the time to perform her other duties. But let's look at that. Yes, it could be done. Where is the yes, it could be done?
Can you wrap up? You're well over 3 minutes.
I know, and so have many other people been well over. So I think that
this
is important enough.
But I'm trying to move the meeting toward a timely end. But why don't you go ahead and complete your comments and wrap up?
I will, indeed. But I think it's rather discriminatory to let some people ramble on a bit and to constrain me over a very important issue. So where is the possibility of doing this in-house? And it's not always about money. There are many people that would like to work for this city because of the environment that we have, because, as Hugel Hauser said, we are part of California's gold. And it's not always about comparative classifications and so on and so forth. And I do not feel this is complete because, as Michelle said, yes, it can be done. So let's see how it could be done. And I took the comments of our expertise in employment law, Buchanan, and we have the firm of Libert, Cassidy & White, who have that expertise in the Fair Labor Standards and the American Disabilities Act, who are currently defending us in an employee lawsuit. And with input from them, I would like to see brought back, which has not been brought back, the request to outline how this could be done. As Michelle said, yes, it can be done. So tell us how it could be done.
Thank you. Okay, other comments?
Hi, I'm Jay Hill, for those of you who might not know me. I'm the associate planner and resident of North Hermosa, as well as the newly elected president of the Classified Employees Association, which represents about half of your non-public safety employees in the city. I passed a petition to Elaine. I don't know if she had a chance to hand that around.
Yes, you okay. Have it.
And it was signed by almost an entirety of our union. And this is in support of this classification and compensation study. And to read it to the public, it states as follows. Honorable Mayor and Councilman, an update of Sierra Madre's job classifications is long overdue. It's important that it be done by specialists who are objective and experienced. As employees of the City of Sierra Madre, we respectfully request that you approve the contract for a classification and compensation study. We appreciate the opportunity to work in Sierra Madre and have made many concessions in the past in view of the city's financial situation. An objective and professionally done job classification study will benefit the city, its employees, and ultimately the residents of Sierra Madre. Approval of this contract will show that the City Council recognizes the importance of the city's employees in keeping Sierra Madre the great community it is. And at our union meeting the other day, we unanimously determined that this was something that we felt very strongly about. And not because we're holding our hand out, we're asking for more money, we're looking at the police and saying, oh, well, they're going to get some, we want some too. This is about three things. This is about legally protecting the city in the event of litigation, in the event that there ever comes, you know, a conflict between job positions, and simply for people to understand their job positions. We have one employee right now who is literally working two positions and still only being paid for one, two legally separate job descriptions, working the exact same, the two jobs. Also, economically, we believe it's important for the city to find and retain the talent that's necessary to keep the city growing strong, and that without understanding what other cities are compensating, what other cities are classifying and requiring for their positions, how can we effectively bring in the kind of talent that are required here? And the last of which is simply the recognition that our employees are working hard, working at a fair rate when compared to regional, competitors of employment, similar to Monrovia, San Marino, the ones around here who would basically be hiring the same kind of people that we would be hiring. So, again, our employee association is 100% behind this, and we would like you to consider that when you make your decision. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you for finishing in 2.5 minutes. Appreciate it. Any other comments?
Marianne McGillivray, Elm Avenue. I guess I'd like to just suggest a word here, and that would be prudent. It's a kind of a highly charged issue because you've had a consultant come up here and speak, and you've had the employee association speak, and the consultant, of course, is going to present a very good case. But I really didn't hear any answer to the question several of you raised, which was, what is the benefit of having the consultant do it over and above having it done in-house? What do you get that's extra? I heard Sandy say it'd be certainly easier in a lawsuit, but I'm not sure that we are really here to fund what's easier. And so I use the word prudent because we are in a financial crisis, and we have a utility tax coming up on the ballot that we have no assurance whether or not it will pass. And if it doesn't pass, we have some issues with the police association that will have to be readdressed, and certainly there will have to be some belt tightening. And so I know that Councilman Buchanan indicated that this is of some urgency because it's a legal requirement, but we haven't done it before, so I don't really see why 12 weeks would make a tremendous amount of difference in completing this now as opposed to 12 weeks from now when you know whether or not the utility tax will offer the kind of funding that's going to be needed to do some other things. So I'd like to offer another suggestion would be to perhaps do some things concurrently, and that would be to hold on to the consultant's report and consider it, but in the meantime, take a look at the possibility of doing it in-house, and maybe our personnel services director can sit with our city administrator and take a look at all of the projects that are on the plate and what the priority level is of those projects and whether or not that priority level can be shifted to some extent so that this project might be started in-house at least. And some of the projects that she's working on could possibly be handed down to the assistant, so that we could, in fact, start this in-house. If we had to start it in-house, I don't think that Big Brother would put the hammer down too hard if he saw that the project was at least in process. So I think that might be a good way to approach it at this point, and I think just as sort of a side commentary, I know we've never done this before, but I think it's hard to come up with the right word right now. It's a little disconcerting to be in a situation where your employees are somewhat unappreciative of the atmosphere in which they're working, and I'm sure unappreciative isn't the right word. I may get some comments on that, but it does appear to be all about money. And there are advantages to working here that are not in some of the other cities that are paying differently. And so if people are doing duplicate jobs, then maybe that's, of course, why we have to do the classification study, because we can redefine what the job is that person is doing and put it into one job. But there are certainly benefits over and above a paycheck to working in this city with this kind of staff. If that isn't realized to the extent that it should be, then the atmosphere here has changed considerably over the last 10 or 15 years. But I would just encourage a little prudence here and take a look at reprioritizing and see if this can't be done in-house, because this money may not be able to be spent after you see what happens to the utility tax.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, other comments?
Barbara Klein, Manzanita. This was an unexpected conversation tonight, and it makes me feel as though the morale in the city needs to be looked at. We have a very fine new city manager. I would like to hear her talk more. Have you noticed that she has almost nothing to say? I would like to see her with more leadership. She has leadership qualities. I would like her to start using them. Evidently, the employees of the city, as Mary Ann has said, not happy. We need to know, I'll use the word ringleader, who is causing this. And as far as the money, we don't have it. I believe one of you have said that we're, 6 months away from disaster? In other words, we don't have that much in the emergency funds. I think that would be a very good topic to put on the agenda. And let's discuss that before the next council meet, or rather at the council meeting. I've seen a change tonight in the climate, and I would like to know what the bottom is, who's at the bottom, and what our city manager, she has been here for quite a few months now. I would like to hear what she has to say about the city, because she is basically the leader of these people. Thank you.
Thank you. Elaine, did you want to add anything, or you want to wait till the end of comments? Oh, I was just asking Elaine, since that was directed to her. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Hi, Barbara Lee, Sermati Boulevard. Yeah, one of the reasons might be because our poor city manager is left taking the minutes, whereas we don't have our person sitting in the chair that used to be here for so many years, but that's up for election.
Well, that has something to do with the salary she was being paid,
I understand. Well, I'd rather have a city manager than a minute taker.
Yeah.
But anyway, if it comes down to hiring this consultant firm, don't look towards San Marino comparison to Sierra Madre. Look towards the cities the same size as Sierra Madre, the same visibility of Sierra Madre monetarily, employees, hours, divisions of jobs, marked down as to what's going to where and being paid. Am I making a little bit of sense? Because I've heard people talk about San Marino, Arcadia, all the cities near us. No, we're not any of those. So if you do okay this, since we haven't had it for 20 years, and I'd also like to know the difference between the suit that's up against the city cost-wise, what will go out the door for that, versus waiting till next year when we can join in with these other cities that will be doing the same study again. Wasn't that part of the talk that we had? There was a few cities that if we join in, the cost could be a lot lower than what we're looking. I believe it was. So let's go ahead and take a look at that and get some money on the table to see what really the line in the sand is before you make a decision on this ADA that's been out of compliance for the last 20 years.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments? Okay, bring it back to council. And I don't know if, Elaine, did you want to add anything to the discussion or want to wait?
I prepared now, Madam Mayor and City Council. I can attempt to respond to a few of the questions that were raised this evening regarding doing this in-house. That was discussed by the staff, and the reason the staff report is before you this evening, still recommending as a consultant, is because after evaluating it, it is staff's opinion that the best course of action is to use a private consultant for all the reasons you've heard this evening, so I won't reiterate those. But the impartiality, they'll get it done much quicker. They have an expertise in this. They have years of experience in many cities that they've done this for. So there's a variety of reasons why, after looking at this, it is my recommendation that at least the classification portion of the study be done. I understand the community's concerns regarding the compensation portion, and staff is prepared as recommended. I think it was recommendation number 2 to just proceed with the classification component because of the sensitivity of the compensation component. I'd have to say that just a general observation, I believe that the majority of city employees here, it's easy, I can see where the perspective is that this is all about money, and really it isn't. I can tell you that 4.5 months I've been here, they are really hard-working, cooperative bunch of staff people who handle more duties and responsibilities than I've seen in other organizations I've been in. It isn't about money. I think it's true what the residents are saying, that Sierra Madre has other benefits aside from just the financial, the work environment, the city itself. I think it's a big decision why you, a big reason why you have the employees that you do have here. On the compensation portion, it's challenging to recruit and retain employees. And as you're aware from past experiences, the new people that come on board, myself included, tend to be first-time city managers, first-time department heads, because we do tend to, I like to use the saying, find a diamond in the rough, somebody who hasn't done yet but has the potential to do it, and identify those individuals and bring them on board. And once they get here, I have to say overall, if the public is sensing some kind of morale issue, I think the employees would all come up and say there isn't a morale issue in Sierra Madre. They do enjoy and appreciate working here. But they also, as expressed by the classified employees who were here this evening, they understand the importance of the classification component. There have been many instances in just the few months that I've been here where there have been issues raised regarding whether a particular employee should be exempt or not, whether they should be, whether they're working out of class or not. Michelle addressed, there was a question raised about the employees, including myself. I fall into a different category because I have a contract with you. But aside from my position, as positions open up, we do update as best as we can the job description so the new folks we hire, it's an accurate reflection of the duties they're going to be doing on a daily basis. But all of our positions don't turn over every year. So there are a number of classifications that haven't been updated in a while. And regarding timing, why now? I wasn't obviously here, a year ago, 2 years ago, 5 years ago, 10 years ago when this wasn't done in the past. My only response to that is that it was budgeted for. The City Council at some point in preparing the current fiscal year budget, this project, the funds were found to be able to do this project. And again, I repeat, they are not general fund dollars. They are internal services fund dollars. And so this year is the year that enough funds have accumulated in that fund to be able to undertake this project. And I'm looking to make sure I've addressed most of the issues raised tonight. If I haven't, you can ask me the questions, and I'd be glad to respond.
Okay, thank you. All right, comments and questions. I'll start on my left. Don?
This is more, I realize how nice it is to have something like this, because then you have a framework to work in. But the problem I have right now is more of a political problem. We're going to go out and spend, and I realize this may be an important study to have done, but we're going to go out and spend $30,000 to do this study. And people are saying to me, what about this utility tax? Why should we be spending any money at all until we really know whether we have the funding to do these things? And to me, if we pass this thing tonight, say, okay, let's go out and spend $30,000 to do this study, what is it going to tell people about the utility tax? To me, it'll be like putting a stake in the heart of this initiative. And to me, it's irresponsible. I think we ought to just wait and see. Personally, I think Faye is right. We ought to really wait and see where we stand financially. The only other, I don't see why it can't wait until we know. In fact, we may be, after the election, looking at ways to reduce government spending, potentially laying people off, and finding other ways of making the city work with a much lower budget. We are working in a situation where we have this big X, expenditures as opposed to income, and slowly watching the expenditures not changing, but we are sure watching the income go down. And if we're going to be going into a recessionary period where things like property tax get reduced and city operating budgets get reduced, we're going to have something a lot more serious to worry about than whether people are classified one way or another. So my personal feeling is I would rather wait and see where we stand after the election, because to me, we need to hear from the people, and that election is going to be critical. That's going to tell me, as an elected person, yes, the people want to spend the money to do all these extra things, or no, we don't, which means we have to start finding ways of reducing expenditures. And it ain't going to be pretty. That's where I see it. So.
Okay, thank you. Kurt?
Lest I be accused of hypocrisy, I have to say I do support a raise for our police department, a raise that would be funded through an increase in the utility tax, for the simple reason that I don't believe they're fairly compensated, and every time they go out, they risk life and limb. And I also support the maintenance of a paramedic program that is also funded through an increase in our utility tax, so the rest of us don't have to risk life and limb. And with all due respect to our diligent, hardworking, devoted, classified employees, they're not similarly situated to our police officers and our paramedics. And taking nothing away from the important services they provide, they're not vital in the same way. At the last city council meeting, I spoke out against the classification study for some of the same reasons that Don articulated this evening, and I echo his comments. But I think the best argument against the classification study, or that part of the classification study that focuses on compensation, we heard a few minutes ago. I couldn't believe it, so I wrote it down. This was what Mr. Hill had to say on behalf of the classified employees. He said they weren't asking for more money or holding their hand out because the police officers are getting a raise. Well, if that's the case, if they're not asking for more money and they're not holding their hand out because the police officers are getting a raise, then respectfully,
we shouldn't be paying for classification study whose primary purpose, and if you read between the lines in the staff report, I mean, it's pretty clear, primary purpose is to come up with raises for the classified employees.
Joe?
Well, essentially going forward, I think we just need to be extremely sensitive to our fiscal situation. The utility user tax, which is on the ballot in April, is an important measure, and I want to do everything I can to make sure that people know how important that measure is for the continuation of vital services like public safety, paramedic services, and also the retention of our police officers. So going forward, there's a little bit of, we don't know where we're at fiscally until after April and until we have the passage or until we know what the status is of the UUT. So I want to be extremely sensitive to the money that we spend right now, and also taking into consideration having just been in Sacramento and knowing the fiscal situation of the state and knowing that there's most likely going to be cutbacks and streams of revenue going to localities. I think we need to be, like I said, extremely sensitive. But I also want to say to the classified employees and essentially to all the employees of the city, we appreciate everything you do. We really do appreciate everything you do. And I don't think that you should see this as a sign of we don't appreciate what you do and that we're not going to work 100% to retain every employee for the city, because we can't move forward without every one of you working 100%. So I ask that you stay with us. And that you don't see this as a sign that we're not going to work on your behalf and to make sure that the environment that you have here with the city is a good one. So just this decision is based on trying to be sensitive to our fiscal situation while we move forward in this kind of period that we don't know what's going to happen until April.
John?
You know, one of the most common statements made about government, and it's a little simplistic, but it has its applications. People always ask why government doesn't run more like a business. Why don't they at least adopt certain business principles in their operations? And every business I know tries to do something like this, because this isn't just trying to figure out whether our employees are paid less than other employees in other cities. If it were that simple a question, you're right, we wouldn't need a study. But the differences in various classifications and the differences in job duties in other cities tend to inform us not only whether they're paid less, but also how much, and also can tell you whether or not you're going to face substantial turnover in the future. And if you're going to face substantial turnover in the future, you're going to have a planning tool with which to make adjustments to assure that either doesn't happen or plan ahead for the inevitability when it does. Business after business after business does this. The consultant's own list of cities that does this includes cities that are small and large. It includes water districts, which has fewer classifications of employees than we do. This isn't just an informational piece, it's a planning tool. So if you want to talk about government operating like a business, this is what a business does. And a business doesn't take it in-house, and I can testify from a business that has an entire human resources department and an employment law section of the law department of which I'm a member, and we would still go out and get outside help to do these evaluations, because you usually don't ask management to make these independent evaluations of the employees and then still expect that the relationship between management and employees is the same. It is also a tool for cost savings. When you know about, if you think it's expensive to retain employees, just try it, just see how expensive it is to constantly replace them and not be able to plan ahead for that. I mean, this may sound simplistic to a lot of folks, but it's not. It is an essential type of management tool that, yes, probably should have been done before. That's no argument for putting it off. And there are implications for job classifications. The exempt, non-exempt status under the FLSA, whether work is union work versus non-union work and you don't get into bargaining unit disputes, whether something is the essential function of a job for ADA and FEHA purposes is very important and is usually found in the classifications. In fact, the job descriptions are one of the key pieces of evidence used in those kinds of suits to determine whether something constitutes an essential function of the job or whether it can be eliminated or reasonably accommodated. There are Equal Pay Act issues. Women in a lot of organizations can testify about the differences for the type of work that they do, which looks awfully similar or even more onerous than what men do, and they somehow or another didn't get the same kind of pay. So, you know, we can go along our way, not avail ourselves of a management tool that we have saved for, and which I dare say if the utility users tax doesn't pass and we have to consider substantial cuts, we're going to need this kind of information anyway to do that kind of decision making. So, you know, we can ignore it and move on and talk about how we're trying to be sensitive to the cost of something. But this is, in my judgment, ultimately being penny-wise and pound-foolish, ignoring a substantial business tool that most other places have seen fit to put into place, and I gotta believe that they understand these issues as well as we do. And it does say something to our employees that we do want to understand their work, what they're paid, because, yes, there are great value psychic dollars to be realized from working in Sierra Madre, but that carries you only so far, and we know it. I've heard every argument that has been made here tonight, I think we're putting our head in the sand. I think this is the right thing to do. We did that. We budgeted for this at our budget time, knowing full well what the budget situation was. I assume we saw some value in it then. I don't see why we don't see the same value in it now. I may be on the losing end of this argument, but I think that's what's right for the city. I think that's what the business perspective calls for. And I think that ultimately will be a cost-saving study, not that will more than make up for the $36,000 cost of this proposal, which, by the way, is low by most standards I've seen. So I just am not going to be penny-wise and pound-foolish here. I'm not going to vote that way. And I really think we should go ahead and do with what we said we were going to do at budget time.
Okay, thank you. I'm extremely disappointed in what seems to be the sense of the council, and disappointed for us and disappointed for our staff. We can dress it up, but essentially we're giving a vote of no confidence in our staff. And we're saying
that I have to disagree with that.
I'll
tell you something. This isn't a vote of no confidence.
Is it my turn?
Yeah, I suppose so, but now you're accusing us of voting.
I said this is my opinion.
Okay.
I'm expressing my opinion, and I gave everybody an opportunity, and we each get a chance to express our opinion. And if you want to rebut me, you're welcome to do that, but I'd appreciate the courtesy and respect for the position to allow me to speak. Thank you. I think that we are expressing a vote of no confidence in our staff, that we don't have to be, it doesn't have to be proven to us that our staff work hard and are underpaid and that we have high turnover. We already know that. Our former city manager walked into a lower level job at a $40,000 increase. Our former Development Services Director, Kirk Christensen, went over to the city of Yorba Linda and brought himself 5 years closer to retirement simply by showing up to work at a different place the next day. Our city manager's assistant went to the city of Burbank and got a significant pay raise. We're telling our employees they can't afford to work here. So to not do a classification and salary study and at least know and basically say that our employees should be partially volunteers or work here at substandard salaries because we're such a wonderful community is not fair. It's not something I would accept as an employee, and I don't think it's the right thing to do. I also agree with Councilmember Buchanan that we are being penny-wise and pound-foolish. We have heard at many council meetings complaints about our legal bills. This study is going to cost $36,000. $36,000 is probably one set of depositions or less. I don't know. I'm not an expert on legal fees in a lawsuit that an employee might bring. And to not do a study that would help us in that legal situation and instead wait for it to hit us, perhaps when we haven't budgeted for it and we're not prepared for it, I think is penny wise and pound foolish. Work environment is very important. I agree. And I think our employees do a fantastic job of giving their all for this city. And we've seen it in many, many circumstances. When it was raining 2 weeks ago, our public works staff was out 24/7 checking the sandbags, checking the pumps up at One Carter, making sure that our city was safe. And I think that has to be regarded by the city, and we need to pay them fairly because they do go above and beyond the call of duty every day that they come to work. I also think that we shouldn't be asking them to work under circumstances that have not been reviewed, classifications that have not been reviewed for years and years. When I was working for a large corporation, they did classification studies and had all of us write down our job duties and rewrite the job descriptions on a periodic basis. And I think the same should be expected in government. If we want our people to work hard and work efficiently, I think that's the least that we can do. So obviously, my position is not the popular one from the comments, and I'm happy to ask Councilmember Watts if you would like to add a comment. My comments are not directed at any members of council. It's my personal opinion that this is not the right course of action.
I think there, if I can, I'm going to try to speak for actually Don and Joe, how's that? If I can grossly but hopefully succinctly summarize some of the points that both of them were making, they weren't rejecting the notion of a classification study out of hand. They were simply saying the timing right now sucks, and it does suck. Yes.
Don?
Okay. When I first started talking, I said it was a good idea. It's a good tool to have. I just thought it was the wrong time to do it, simply because the perception of people are going to see it as just another expense that we're putting the city through in order to do these things. And all I am saying is, I am not going to be the one to single-handedly put a stake in this initiative. If you want to go ahead, you go ahead and vote for this. But personally, I think it's a mistake, because perception is everything in this town. If you go ahead and do this, people are going to see it that way. So go ahead. I know how I'm going to vote. I'm going to say postpone this until after the election and see where we stand financially. And yes, it's a good idea to do this study, but I am not saying that the employees of this town are not worth it. That wasn't my intent to say that. I thank you.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments?
Well, can I just say that I hope we all certainly appreciate our employees and their work. For those of us who see it firsthand and experience, you know, sometimes the benefits of it, I think we know what it is. I guess, Don, the problem I have with the idea is that, I don't know, I think our population, I give them a little more credit for understanding that there's an enterprise to run here. And there comes with it certain costs of running it. And what I feel confident is that regardless of what happens in the election, we're going to need this. And if the election doesn't go the way I hope it does with respect to the UUT, we're probably going to need it even more. And it's going to be more expensive then. So I think the people will, if we talk about it intelligently, the people will get that. I'm confident they have greater, they will show greater support for their town than to, I think, be penny wise and pound foolish, or, you know, stick the head in the sand. I forget all the metaphors we want to use right now, but this is important to the operation of this city. It's important to the financial operation of this city. It's important to the, it's important to our city employees. I think those are very compelling reasons to do what we say we were going to do at budget time. And I really think our town will understand that. And so I think we're going to, I think we should, what was the statement I heard? It's never the wrong time to do, it's always the right time to do the right thing. And I think this is doing the right thing.
Okay, well, we clearly don't have a consensus, so I'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to move that we table this till meeting after the April election, and that we also give directions to staff to start to plan to show us a way to do this in-house.
I'll second that question.
Okay, moved and seconded. Is there any other discussion? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, all opposed?
No.
Okay. Okay, motion carries 3-2. Excuse me, if you would like to make a public comment, Faye, why don't you come up to the microphone? You don't want to make a public comment. Okay. All right, thank you. Then moving on to item 5, appeal of the Tree Commission, Advisory Commission action in the removal of two eucalyptus trees from the parkways adjacent to 390 and 399 North Baldwin.
Good evening, Mayor and members of the City Council. At its December 19th meeting, the Tree Advisory Commission approved the removal of two eucalyptus trees from parkways adjacent to 390 and 399 North Baldwin. On December 28th, staff received a written appeal of that Tree Commission action, and a copy of that appeal is attached to this report. The Tree Commission has been dealing with these trees since 2003, and the staff report contains a timeline, if you will, of the various actions that the Commission has taken. I won't bore you with that lengthy discussion. The trees in question, however, have been discussed repeatedly by the Tree Commission. The Commission has not acted precipitously in this, but rather has hesitated over a number of years to approve this removal. The Tree Commission does not take removals lightly and often states some of the same concerns that were voiced in the December 28th appeal during their deliberations. However, the Commission has reached a unanimous consensus on the subject of these two trees, as voiced at the December 19th meeting. There are multiple reports from arborists on file that have stated that these trees are a hazard. They have differed to some degree as to the degree of the hazard. Nevertheless, the arborists are in agreement that these trees pose a structural hazard. Therefore, the Tree Commission has approved this removal as a matter of public safety. It's the recommendation of both the Commission and staff that the safety of motorists, pedestrians, and residents of the area adjacent to these trees, that public safety must take a higher priority than the aesthetic value of the trees. Therefore, staff recommends that the City Council uphold the recommendation of the Tree Advisory Commission and direct staff to remove the eucalyptus trees from the parkways at 390 and 399 North Baldwin. And with that, I would be happy to answer any questions you have.
Bruce, I have a question for you. Attachment B is an email
ray these trees, and there's a statement in the email that says, quote, they have been deemed healthy, unquote. Has there been any report or study generated by an arborist that came to that conclusion that they've been deemed healthy?
None of the arborist reports have specifically addressed the matter of health. They're silent on the issue of health. The arborist reports, however, are in agreement that because of the growth pattern of these trees, because of the way they've been trimmed, and because of tree species characteristics, these trees are at risk of structural failure. Health has not been the issue here.
Okay, I guess, yeah, I'm confused by the difference between structural failure and health.
Yeah.
I'd say a tree that's on the verge of structural failure is unhealthy, but maybe that's not a
term. It would have been helpful to have had one of these arborists here tonight. Unfortunately, I don't have that luxury. But again, we do have the written reports that do state that even being silent on the issue of health, they have stated clearly that there are hazards in the structure of these trees.
I think maybe the shortcut answer to this is we don't have any arborist report that indicates that these trees are safe. Is that correct, Bruce?
That is correct.
Okay.
And just so I'm clear, they are actually on city property, is that correct?
Yes, they are.
Okay.
Any other questions?
For the sake of public disclosure, I'd like to say that I've met with Deanne Tyron, who is actually wrote the appeal. Met with her just to take a look at the property and look at the trees and just listen, and that was about it. I'd also like to thank Catherine for staying here, the chairperson of our tree commission, who's stayed here throughout the entire debate, and thank you. You know what I'd be interested in hearing, Catherine, is I know that somewhere in the memo that we got, there have been plans that outlined as far as beautifying Baldwin, northern parts of Baldwin. So when these trees are taken out, as the other two were, that we're actually planning on putting other trees up there too.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. The decision was to plant a mixture of coast live oak, Engelmann oak, and ginkgo trees along that area, actually. Because what we want to do is create a continuation of that alley effect that goes from Orange Grove up to near Baldwin, and continue that after the city center back up, continuing up Baldwin.
Right.
And, so, you know, if you guys haven't, excuse me, if the city council hasn't, I'm pretty informal, if the city council hasn't taken a look at the eucalyptus trees, I took some pictures yesterday, if you want to see them, that indicate that the canopy of the eucalyptus trees is very sporadic. Normally a well-cared-for eucalyptus has a very full canopy that is open and allows the wind to go through. These trees have been cut back and caused sprouts at the places where they were cut back, because that's what eucalyptus do. They will sprout very easily, which creates bunches of green growth that's very heavy. And you had asked a question about the possibility of a healthy tree still being structurally fail, the capability of it structurally failing. Let me rephrase that. Yes, healthy trees, I'm not an arborist, but I do know that healthy trees do structurally fail. And sometimes they do it when there's a drought situation. They will, what I call, shed branches because it's too hot for them to support all of that weight and leaf when there's not enough water. That's just one example. These trees, they're not structurally sound. And if you want to see the pictures, I've got them.
Okay. All right.
Do you have any other questions?
And you guys heard or received two reports from two separate arborists?
Yes.
All right. And who hired the first arborist to do the report?
That was WCA, was it not? It was the city.
The city hired the first arborist?
Yes.
And who hired the second arborist?
City.
And both reports said that they're structurally, that they pose a structural hazard to the streets. All right. What I think, Bruce, at some point it said something about that we could mitigate some of the structural defects or the structural hazards that it presents by doing some things to the tree. I mean, the only thing I guess conceptualize is the tree in Kirsten Court with all the metal bars, but these things are massive. So what are they saying as far as reinforcing these trees to make them not a structural hazard?
There were recommendations to do some trimming to remove some of the weight off of these branches. There was also a recommendation to do some cabling. There are examples of cabling in, for instance, one of the large oak trees on the east side of South Baldwin, down by Orange Grove. These are all expensive processes, though, and both of those arborist reports, with their declaration of hazards, even the latest one that was done, indicated that these trees are not viable in the long term. So any funds that we would spend now on trimming them, on cabling them, would be simply throwing good money after bad.
Thank you.
Bruce or Catherine, can you address what the timeline is for replacing the trees? And I mean, is there other work that needs to be done in order to do the re-landscaping plan that you're looking at?
The commission has the North Baldwin landscape plan, if you will, on their agenda for their February meeting.
Mm-hmm.
They've already discussed it at their January meeting, decided they wanted to spend a little bit more time on it, so it's coming back. At the February meeting, they will select which trees go at which locations, and we have trees in our tree bank that can be planted. We have Edison indicating that they're going to donate some trees, and through the efforts of Marilyn Diaz, and a contact that she made, someone is donating 40 ginkgo biloba trees to the city. So I don't think there's going to be a shortage of replacement trees to go back in there. It's just a matter of the decision as to which tree goes in which location.
Okay, thank you. All right, any other comments from council? Thanks, Bruce. Okay, we'll open it up to community comment. Is there anyone here who'd like to comment on this appeal?
Hello, Deanna Tryon, resident of North Baldwin Avenue. Thank you, Mayor Jaffe and members of the City Council for addressing this issue regarding the removal of the last two remaining eucalyptus trees on North Baldwin Avenue. There were three other trees on this block that were removed back in July. I'm basically here, despite a crippling fear of public speaking, to ask for your help in considering a stay of execution for these beautiful, vital, healthy, century-old trees that are, according to the Sunset Garden Book, absolutely perfect trees for windy areas, and North Baldwin is definitely a very windy area. During the last year, we've had several big windstorms, and not a branch has fallen from either of these two remaining trees. I do understand that the position of city staff to want to remove rather than maintain these two trees, and that there is a designated amount in their budget currently to remove these trees. But I did read the staff report on this issue tonight, and I do disagree a little bit with the way it was presented for a few reasons. I think I have three or four here. And first, Councilmember Zimmerman, you asked about the arborist report and talk about, you know, any discussion of health. And I do have the arborescence report from May of 2007 that does describe these trees as having average health. And a big deal here is that the staff report said that they had a failure potential of 11, but in this report they list both of these two remaining trees with a failure potential of 4. So there's a big discrepancy there. I could pass this around if you would like. And probably every healthy tree in this city would rate a 4. And I also noticed that during some of the windstorms, I think they were last January, there were a bunch of city-planted trees that toppled in the city center. And these have been so strong, I just, you know, I'm fighting for these trees. The second point I have is that the staff report states that the vote by the Tree Commission to take these trees off the watch list, which they were originally supposed to be on a watch list to be watched over the next decade or so, and destroy them, was unanimous, and it was not. There was one member of the Tree Commission who did vote against that. Third, the staff report fails to mention that these two trees were not supposed to be removed
after the 2007 report was presented in May. They were supposed to go on a watch list. And fourth, you should all have copies of letters from the neighbors. I believe there are two offers to privately fund the maintenance of these two trees. I believe there are enough disagreements that I'm asking you to consider this appeal. And I also believe that the city destroying healthy trees, and I will pass this around if you would like, does set kind of a negative precedent. When they did remove the three trees in July, and there was one, the 441 tree, did have significant damage, and you could see it in the core. But unfortunately, the 399 South tree, it was, I think, according to the arborist who lives in my building, good wood all the way through. And it was very, very sad to see that tree go. But thank you very much, and I'd also like to thank the Tree Commission for putting up with me and Bruce Inman as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And maybe you could pass that report around. I'd like to see it. Any other comments?
Don't be afraid of public speaking. You did just
right,
fine.
You did great. You did great.
Madam Mayor, members of the council, I think she did great too. My name is Barbara Covarrubias, and I'm Deanna's mother. And I drove down today from Northern California to bring you some information that I hope will help in your deliberation, because these two remaining trees out of all of the ones that have been removed now do have potential. And this is what, may I approach the council?
Sure. Mm-hmm.
I took these pictures before I left, and you can pass them around if you want, but this is...
I'm just going to ask you if you would, you're welcome to come up and hand out pictures, but then if you could go back to the microphone to speak, because otherwise it won't pick up on the recording, okay?
I took that picture of a tree that the city of Los Altos maintains properly, which is the same height, the same species, the same everything as the trees that are remaining on North Baldwin. Now, my daughter has lived here for many years, and we all come here, the family. We love Sierra Madre, and we have enjoyed her neighborhood for quite some time. I was, throughout the 80s, long before cameras, on a city council and served two terms as mayor and went through a lot of tree issues. And I also was chair of the League of California Cities Public Safety Committee. I've worked on the on fire reports throughout the state, and especially the Oakland fire and other such issues. I also know an awful lot from the arborist reports on some of these tree issues. And I know that the most likely tree to drop branches is the oak to cause damage. So it's not just that eucalyptus are difficult trees to maintain. What it is that they are not maintained properly. So I wanted to give you a positive example rather than everyone always says, oh, these trees are not maintained properly. I wanted to show you how a city very similar to Sierra Madre maintains a street tree, a street eucalyptus. And everyone loves that tree, and frankly, no city council would survive removing that tree. But I do know that there are not very many examples of them being properly pruned, so I wanted to bring that to you. I also wanted to ask for you to please consider the historic nature of these trees. People develop plans where they see a beautiful plan for a street and they want certain types of trees. But there are historic trees that can exist very happily within other groups of trees. I also know that trees bring tremendous value to neighborhoods by height, and you will not see any trees that you plant now attain that height within our lifetimes, probably, because those trees, I believe, are about 100 years old. The arborist report that I saw declared that the trees were healthy. The failure rate was no different than many other trees all throughout the city. But there's a very strong feeling among many people that it's best to just make sure there's no risk whatsoever. And some people feel that eucalyptus trees are very tall and that they are very dense, and therefore something might happen someday. But you could say the same thing about all the oak trees all the way throughout the city, many other species as well. These trees should be given an opportunity to be pruned properly before they are killed and destroyed. I know it's more convenient, and staff and the commission are obviously ready to do it, but I would appreciate very much a little bit more time and a proper pruning job on these trees in lines with what I brought you. And I don't think I've ever sat so long in one day in my life, and I have had many long council meetings, but having driven down here starting at 7:30 this morning, I thought I've never sat all that long. So I do appreciate you listening. I hope that you appreciate the spirit in which these suggestions are offered. It's certainly positive. I understand the liability issues. I've been an elected official for many, many years. I do know that this tree, according to the arborist report I saw, is no more likely than other trees to fail. And these two are deemed healthy according to the reports that I've read. So I'm asking you to please give them the one last shot that they have never had, which is to be properly pruned. And I think the neighborhood values, the home values in the neighborhood, will be much higher for a much longer period of time with at least one or two mature trees in that area. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Other comments? Okay, then we'll come back to council. And are there any questions or comments?
Bruce, did you want to address the difference? I'm just actually looking at this right now, so I don't know if there is a difference, but the claim difference between the memo that we got and this report. Is it a 4 rating or?
Yeah, there's a typo in my report, and I apologize for that. I did not intend to overstate the hazard rating on that.
That's on which one?
The 399. On the bottom of page 2, where I listed the hazard ratings.
Mm-hmm.
I've got a typo there. The hazard rating should be as is spelled out in the arborescence report.
For the north tree on 399.
So it says, in the report, it says 399 North Tree. It says failure potential is 4. Then it lists hazard rating 9. What's the difference between the failure potential and the hazard rating?
The hazard rating is what is listed in the staff report.
Well, what do they mean?
Well, that's I don't have that report in front of me. I have just the staff report, the staff memo. But the hazard rating and the failure rating were defined in more detail in the arborescence report.
Now, I know that the staff report mentioned that residents had volunteered to perform normal maintenance, I guess was the term used.
That's correct.
Yeah. And I guess two issues were raised in the staff report. One, that these trees need more than normal maintenance because they've not been treated properly over their lives or they're the way they've been pruned. And so do we have any idea of what the cost would be to bring those trees back to, if they are in fact sound structurally, which we don't know for sure, to bring them back to a, you know, circumstance, would they be less hazardous?
No, we did not. We have not gone out and sought proposals from anyone to go out and do the kind of trimming that would be required on those trees, which is in excess of what our arborist normally does, what we would consider normal. Nor have we gotten any estimates on cabling these trees, mm-hmm. as was referred to in the arborescence report.
Okay. Then the other question I had is, even if residents, as you know, we've mentioned at other council meetings that residents can volunteer to do maintenance on trees in the city parkway because of our limited budget. But we're still responsible, right, if something happened. We can't assign the responsibility, or a citizen can't accept responsibility for anything that happens.
We do have
tree failure.
It is, no one has ever actually entered into one of these agreements, but the Tree Commission, working with former city attorney Michael Colantuno, had worked up an agreement under which the adjoining property owner not only accepts the full maintenance responsibility for the tree, but accepts the liability along with it. Mm-hmm. So I've yet to see anyone volunteer to undertake that, because it might be difficult for them to get insurance on such a thing.
Okay, maybe Sandy can comment on that. Is that something, if the residents were to choose to accept responsibility and liability for the trees, is that even possible?
They can't.
They can agree to indemnify the city, but that doesn't take the city off the hook. It just gives us someone to go after in the event of a lawsuit.
Okay.
I'm not sure what the ratings mean. By looking at this, it breaks down three components, and then it gives it an overall rating. And the 1 through 12, I don't know if that applies to the overall or if it applies to the certain components. So I guess what I'm trying to get at is this report actually telling us that there's a structural hazard and that exists greater than any other tree that poses a structural hazard?
The 1 through 12, there is a total of 12 points, if you will. And then in each of the subcategories, there are 4 points. So you look at the failure rating, that 4 point is 4 out of 4 points. Four out of four. Then you have the other ratings of the tree, which cumulatively add up to as much as 12. So if you have a hazard rating of 7, then you have a 7 out of 12 chance, perhaps, of a failure for that tree. That's the best I can explain it as it's coming back to me from having read that report.
I have it here, if you want. As Bruce just explained, the total rating is the sum of 3 parts. It is, number one, the tree's health and structural condition. Number two, the likelihood of failure. And number three, the likelihood that a person or object would be injured or damaged should a failure occur. So for the 390 Baldwin tree, the hazard rating is 7 in this report, the May 7 report. It is a failure potential of 2. Then they call it the evaluation of the part likely to fail is a 2, and the target rating, which is the likelihood that something or someone would be injured, is a 3, added up to a 7. By contrast, the south 399 Baldwin tree is an 11, as you saw in your staff report, with a failure potential of 4. The likelihood that the entire tree would fail makes it an additional 4 for the second component and a target rating of 3. Let me find the...
And that 4 is 4 of 4 possible north points? Tree.
Correct.
Okay.
I'm concerned that the maintenance of these trees exposes the city to liability both for property damage and personal injury for the reasons articulated by the city attorney. And based on the citation to a California Supreme Court case. But I'm also concerned that we're asking collectively important questions about the hazard ratings at this meeting tonight. And my strong preference would be to table this until the next city council to give all of us an opportunity to study both of the arborist reports in detail.
And perhaps the arborist or representative could be present to answer questions.
Okay.
I don't know if that's the consensus of the council. Mm-hmm. I'm not in a hurry to cut down any trees if we don't have to.
Other comments?
I think that would be my preference too. Let's look at the report and get more information, and perhaps have the arborist here.
Okay, we want the arborist to prepare the report that was passed around.
Yes.
Okay.
Is this comment time? We comment? I used to have 4 eucalyptus trees in my yard, along with about 6 pines. And to me, the failure rate of all trees really depends upon the health of the tree, not the species, and the four eucalyptus trees I had failed suddenly. with no indication of failure, potential failure. Of course, the same thing happened with the pine trees. So to me, to say, yeah, we've got this, this special table that tells us potential risk is sort of like saying, well, let's all go wage bet at Santa Anita and try to determine whether or not it's risky enough to save a tree is, to me, kind of like handicapping, handicap a tree. So to me, I think what the problem really is not the tree, but the maintenance of the tree. If the tree was properly maintained, it would fall. It would have any more risk than any other tree in the town, whether it's oak or pine or whatever. And to me, they cut the tree down simply because we think eucalyptus is less or more unsafe than any other tree. It's not a good reason. And to me, it's really we ought to be taking a closer look at the arborist report to see if those trees are healthy, because that's really more important as to whether or not we're going to be waging bets on which tree is going to fall down first. So I'd rather like to see a table too. Okay.
John? Well, I mean that's obviously the consensus of the group. I guess I don't have any major problem taking time to actually read the report. I would trust our tree commission generally on these subjects, since they've given it more attention than we probably can or will. And I do suspect that the maintenance cost of a tall eucalyptus and cabling it and everything else is going to be more onerous than most people think. And I think the major difference here is, though, that we'd have, yes, a lot of trees can fail, but here we have specific indications, specific information set in front of us about these trees. And so we're going to have to deal with the fact that we have specific information, whereas the trees in your backyard probably didn't have quite the same evaluation done. And, you know, you're charged with the knowledge that's been put in front of you, and that's a risk factor I'm not sure we should be taking. But it sounds to me like the rest of the group wants to read the report. I guess I don't have a major, I can't have a major objection to that, I suppose. If that's the, you know, part of, if that's the sense of the body that's going to make this decision.
Yeah. You know, I think Don brought up one other good point that I think that we should think about, which is that this whole thing about maintenance and revenue to maintain our trees properly. We've heard time and time again that we're not maintaining our trees here in the tree capital of San Gabriel Valley. We're not maintaining these trees because we don't have the revenue, the source of income to do that. I think that this year, I think we actually saw an increase in the cost of doing that and a decrease in the amount of trees that we're actually going to trim. So it's something like a 30-year process to get your tree trimmed in the city. So, I mean, I think that this is something that's very important and perhaps something that Catherine, the commission, can work with the city council on. Perhaps this is something that we can bring up at our next strategic planning session, where we can talk about how do we get to the point where we have enough money to trim the trees in the city so that they're not posing any kind of danger to residents or to families here in the city.
Okay. Well, we seem to have a consensus to put this off to the next meeting, and I'm fine with that, although I have to say, glancing at the arborist report, I'm not sure that an arborist can actually tell us what the health of the tree is, but I guess we'll find out when he's here, because the part that I looked at said that there was evidence of beginning decay, and with the other trees that were taken down, you couldn't tell that. I was looked at two of them at least, and you couldn't tell from the outside, and then when they cut it, it was completely hollow inside, and one had basically beehive in it, and the other one was just hollowed out. So I don't, you know, I'm not sure that we will get any more information, but I'm fine with postponing it and see if we can. Did you want to add anything, Sandy?
Just that I recommend, if you're going to continue it, that you bring it back at your very next meeting.
Okay. All right, so do I get a motion to continue to the next
meeting? I move that we continue it to the next meeting.
Second.
Okay, any other discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, motion carries. All right.
I just wanted to add one thing. I used to have a crippling fear of public speaking, too, and then my sister reminded me that I did some much more embarrassing things in college, which I won't share with anybody tonight.
And we promise that you don't have to drive down from Northern California again for the next meeting. But thank you for coming. Okay, we have next is item number 6, award of contract for City Hall Basement Emergency Operations Center. Bruce?
The need for an expanded EOC has been identified through our experiences with using the existing break room at the police department during both real emergencies and emergency preparedness drills. That room simply doesn't have adequate space to provide an efficient emergency operations center. Funding has been received from the Federal Justice Department for construction of a larger replacement facility, which would use the basement of City Hall. The project will entail the construction of a telephone and computer equipment room in the basement, the installation of an elevator, which is mandated by ADA to provide access from the main floor of City Hall to the basement, and the creation of one large room, which may be used as a public meeting space when not in use as an EOC. That room would also be used as the fire department meeting room. The fire department, as you know, has been displaced from the upstairs area at the public safety building since the beginning of the paramedic program. Three bids have been received for the project. The low bidder was Edwin G. Bowen Company with a low base bid of $295,534. Staff checked references on that company. We received favorable responses from Glendora Unified School District, from LA Valley College, and from the Paramount Unified School District. We also received an excellent response from the San Marino Unified School District. We have checked the contractor's state license and found that that license is current and active, and no complaints are disclosed on that search. The city was awarded a COPS technology grant by the U.S. Department of Justice in the amount of $300,000. This funding source can only be utilized for the construction of the EOC. We cannot use it for any other city function. The bid amount of $295,000 allows a small amount to cover change orders. However, should change orders arise through the construction process, and there's always a potential for that to happen, staff is requesting that the City Council approve a total of 15% in contingencies, a total of $44,330 for the project. That would be comprised of the $4,600 remaining in the grant and an appropriation of $39,700 from general fund reserves. Our intent in bringing this contingency to you for approval at this point is to avoid having to delay the project once it's underway to bring change orders back to the City Council for approval. Staff recommends that the City Council award a construction contract to Edwin G. Bowen Company in the amount of $295,434 for the construction of an emergency operations center in the basement of City Hall, and to provide an additional appropriation from general fund reserves in the amount of $39,700 to cover the construction contingencies. And I'd be happy to address any questions.
Questions? Go ahead. Okay.
Bruce, what's the city's experience been with contractors and change orders?
You know, it varies from projects. From one project to another. We've had some projects that we've had a lot of change orders. Most of our projects have been pretty good, though. 15% is perhaps a little bit high in terms of our experience, but we just want to make sure we've got some coverage. We're finding that when we get into buildings like this, we often discover things that weren't shown on the plans that cause additional costs to arise.
Thank you.
So we want to be covered in case that happens.
Other comments, questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Is there structural work involved in this?
Yes.
Okay, is the company hiring an outside structural engineer or architect, or is it just a...
We've had the architecture and structural work completed already. In terms of the design for that, yes. That was completed under an earlier approval by the city council.
But they were independent of the contract?
Yes.
Okay, good. That's it.
Having dealt with the whole Caltrans thing, and I know that you worked really hard on that, and and got us our money there. What I was saying is, I was referring to the Caltrans and the Chancery Flats Road. We had applied for grant at some point, and it was $500,000 that we paid for the improvements to the road, and then it took a long time for us to get our money. Coming, being so close to that whole situation and having just got our money for that, I guess I'm just battle weary about these dates. So I just want to make sure that I know that we had at some point moved all the boxes from the basement, because we had to move really quickly to spend this money, this federal grant, before the end of 2007.
Right.
In our memo now, it says that the date is... the grant is to expire is June 30th, 2008.
That is correct. I do have that in writing from the Justice Department directly. In fact, I believe it is signed by Melissa Fieri Petro, the Associate General Counsel for the Justice Department Grants Division.
All right. So. And we got this grant with the help of our congressman or senator, right? And so all this stuff, I assume we're passing all the stuff to you with the congressman staff, just to make sure that they're all understanding of where we're at and what we're doing.
Sure. Yeah, we're keeping them updated as to what's going on.
All right. So you're asking for this additional sum because the time schedule could be condensed, and we want to make sure that we're going to operate within that June 30th date. All right. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else?
Yeah, I would say the experience was any delay in construction costs only mean you're paying more for construction. It's one of those unfortunate things. You would think maybe with a decline in the housing market that would not be the case, but the actual cost of construction materials for this kind of stuff don't seem to be abating. Worldwide demand is seen to that, so I think this is probably actually a prudent use of something to secure the completion of an emergency operations center that I think is a vital component of our public safety net in the city.
Is this something that we're required to do, or we're doing just because it's a good idea and we didn't have an EOC before, or an adequate EOC?
Well, the EOC facility is a critical part of the city's emergency response system and meeting the state's SIMS emergency response program, as well as the new federal emergency response program that's patterned after the state program. So we need to have an actual place to have these operations. And as I noted, the room that we've been using now is just way too small.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I think we're good. All right, is there any community comment on this item?
Russ, first of all, I don't have anything to complain about. Bruce covered why we had to do this, why we have to do it now. He covered everything, including that we do have changes that take place in construction. The only thing I would plead is let's stay with as closely as we can to what we submitted for this $295,000, which we know we have, and save another $39,000 from our general fund. That's my only hope.
Thank you.
Hi, Barbara Lee, Sierra Madre Boulevard. I would like to know, is there a chance that we could just build the ramp in place of the elevator? I know the school that we have, our elevator is out of commission, and we're a special education school. I know the ramp would take up more room, but is that another way that we could save some of the money?
It's in the basement.
It's just one story down, yeah.
Let's let Bruce respond to that.
The original concept for this project included a ramp in the area behind City Hall. At the time it was priced, the ramp with all the excavation and retaining wall work was going to end up, it was pretty much a push between that and the type of elevator we were going for. So we decided to go ahead with the elevator. We did the environmental for this project based on this being completely contained within the existing building footprint. When we started getting our cost estimates back that were pushing the $300,000 envelope, I went back to the attorney that I've been working with in D.C. and I said, hey, this isn't going to be that much of a change from the environmental. Can we possibly just go with a ramp? She said, no, you'll have to do your CEQA and NEPA all over again. Mm. And at that point, the schedule just doesn't allow for doing that. And again, we're not entirely sure that with the amount of work that we would have to do to the exterior of the building, modifying some of the footings for this building that extend out behind, that it would be cost effective to do that.
Okay, thank you. All right, any other comment from the audience? All right, then I'll bring it back to council. And what's your pleasure?
I move that we award a construction contract to Edward G. Bowen Company in the amount of $295,434 for the construction of the EOC in the basement of City Hall, and to provide an additional appropriation from general fund reserves in the amount of $39,700 to cover construction contingencies.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Any other comments or questions? Okay, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries. All right, that ends the City Council agenda. I'm going to adjourn to convene a meeting of the Redevelopment Agency, and seeing all members present, I'll ask the City Manager to go through the consent calendar.
Madam Mayor and City Council members, there's one item on the consent calendar this evening at 7A. It's a recommendation that the City Council authorize payments on behalf of the CRA for January 22nd, 2008 in the amount of $8,957 for fiscal year ending June 30th, 2008.
Okay, is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Second, okay. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. All right, then we will move back to the City Council meeting, and are there any other items to be put on future agendas?
Madam Mayor, I have two items that I'd like to put on future agenda. The first one is I'd like to have a discussion on R1 design standards. This is something that we've spoken about before. I think this is critically important in our community, and I'd like to have this on a future agenda. I know that the Planning Commission is taking this up, but what I think that we can do is, I don't want to step on anybody's toes, but I want to have a discussion and formulate some policy from the council so that the Planning Commission knows where we're going with this item with response to R1 design standards.
Okay. Where is the Planning Commission on R1 design standards?
They're going through a list of modifications, not particularly R1, but mm-hmm. other areas. I've been watching the Planning Commission meetings from home as opposed to being at the meetings, because I was told that if I make any comments that I might have to recuse myself from voting. Consequently, while I am the liaison, I don't have anything to do with them because I'm afraid to, because I'll lose that right to vote. So, but that's basically, so if anybody talks to them, yeah, I guess you got to do it through the city manager somehow without compromising your ability to vote. So I don't know what you do. I mean, this is what I have been told, so this is apparently the way it is. Now, you can talk to the city attorney about it, but that's what I was told.
Well, I think we're going to talk about the liaison issues on a future agenda, but then that would be a good point to discuss. So in terms of where the commission is at, I guess, first of all, is there consensus to put this on an agenda? Or at least one of
those. I don't have any objection to discussing it.
Okay. I think it's a good idea.
And then I guess the question is the timing in relationship to what the Planning Commission's progress is. So, and whether we're, it would be great if they were at a point where we could kind of go back and forth.
Can we just basically discuss this at the city council level and just determine this without going through the Planning Commission?
And that's my intention, is to at least, I know that this is an issue the Planning Commission's going to hear in the future. And again, I'm not trying to step on their toes, but I'd like to at least start the conversation, because again, this is critically important. So we can start the conversation and probably give the Planning Commission some, you know, some idea of where we're heading with this and what we feel is important. So that's kind of my intention with this. I have one other item that I'd also like to have on a future agenda, and that is I'd like to discuss putting forth a resolution to support extended producer responsibility. I don't know if you've heard about that, but essentially it would be a resolution requesting that our state legislature take into consideration legislation that would extend producer responsibility. Essentially, that producers that are creating different items that are clogging up our landfills, that we put more responsibility on them to create items that are not disposable, or that they work with us and work with different communities throughout the state of California to come up with ways of managing the disposal. Currently, cities throughout the state of California are having to deal with this themselves. One of the seminars that I attended essentially gave us a heads up on fluorescent light bulbs. I didn't know this, and I'm sure that most other people don't know this, that if you break a fluorescent light bulb, it contains a lot of mercury in it. It's very hazardous. And I think many people are in the dark on that, no pun intended. So I think that we're seeing a rise in the level amount of stuff that's going to, even though we have all this diversion and ACD, and we're still seeing a rise in the amount of stuff that's going to the landfill. So put more of an onus and burden on the producers of these items to come up with ways of managing them and ways of designing products that don't have to go to the landfill. So that's a discussion item I'd like to have on a future agenda. And I actually have a resolution.
That's fine.
Okay.
Sounds good to me. For a minute, I thought we were getting into the whole writer's strike thing before.
Yeah, I was wondering what producers were you talking about. So.
And Mayor Jaffe, if I could, regarding timing, there was at the special meeting on Saturday, the three council members present, a request to keep the February agendas on the light side because of the Stonehouse Settlement Agreement, which will be on your first meeting and agenda. So, assuming we resolve that at the first meeting in February, we could place these discussion items on your second meeting in February. I'm just wanting to make sure the council is aware that should that the Stonehouse issue go over to the second meeting by some chance, that these items might come back in March, just regarding some timing issues.
You know, if I might suggest, I mean, these are Councilmember Mosca's proposals. And one of his concerns, obviously, is where the Planning Commission is vis-a-vis R1 standards and the like. I don't have any problem, you know, leaving it to him to sort of make sure that, you know, he's satisfied that these items are not going to be stepping all over something and cramming into an agenda. As Mayor Pro Tem, I think he should probably, you know, work with staff to make sure that they come for us at an appropriate time, and it doesn't necessarily have to be the next meeting. I don't.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yes.
Is everybody else okay with that?
Yep.
Yeah. All right.
Okay, then I think we're done with the agenda. I'll ask for a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
All right, I'll second the so moved.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Any objection?
Aye.
Okay. Hey, I fooled you. Okay, so ordered. Okay, thank you.